of all creation, of water, earth, and sky. The heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. Universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy.
Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth.
Well, hello, check, 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 am I on? Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. Okay, what, unfortunately? Yeah, unfortunately I can hear you, stop talking. Yeah, about how that works. I don't know how y'all are. All right. Well, welcome. Are you gonna be hanging out with us? No? They're running on Baptist time. All right, well, we'll go ahead and get started with what we are here for, and anyone that moseys on in late can just join on in. So, all right, reminder of what it is we're doing here and what we're talking about and what we're covering. Our current series, because I have an obsession with naming things, is called Having a Strong Core. And taking that from kind of two different ideas. One idea being, you know, like from the earth, right? The earth, it's the core of the earth that forms a magnetic field of the earth. And the magnetic field of the earth protects us from all the harmful radiation and things coming off the sun and other areas of space and all that. And so having a strong core means a strong magnetic field, so the earth is protected. In the same way, if we have a strong core to our faith, then we are protected against all the crazy ideas of the world that that we come across and all the criticisms and doubts and all that sort of fun stuff. And so the core stays strong, we stay all good. The second place I'm getting this from, the real reason I'm using core is because I am, wait, look, we got a verse. We're in church, we can quote Bible verses. I got this out of order. That wasn't supposed to be there. Okay. The other place I get this from is the book that I'm totally plagiarizing from, not actually, I'm just kind of generally following his outline. Core Facts by Dr. Braxton Hunter. I would encourage anyone to look him up, check that out. There's actually a link in the description of this video. We did the second half. The book is Core Facts, and the facts, if you remember, that was the facts of history that showed that the resurrection did indeed happen. Now we're looking at the core, which is four things that show God indeed does exist, and that stands for C-O-R-E, cause, order, rules, and experience. Four things that show God exists. Last week, we looked at cause, right? If the universe began to exist, then the universe had to have had a cause, right? Because anything that begins to exist, you can't create yourself, so there had to be something there to create it. And we went through how all of that points to God. And so you can go check that out from last week if you missed it. Today, however, we're looking at how the universe has order, how there's order and design in the things that we see. The scientific term that you'll hear thrown around if you're reading up on this or listening to people talk about it is fine-tuning, that there's things in the universe that are just so that if they're even slightly different, things would fall apart. And we'll see that here in a bit. The idea that as we see order, the big, you know, 50-cent word that the eggheads like to use is called teleological. coming from the Greek word that means end or goal. It means that something actually has a purpose to it. Then when we look at the features of the universe and the things in the world around us, there's a goal, there's design, there's purpose. It's not just random, just slapped together, that there actually is purpose and order to it. And so that's what we will be looking at tonight. What's that? Where do I find the words? I make them up. I just make them up. Yeah. There's not even really a Greek language. That's just something preachers talk about. It's not real. It's a geek language. The weird thing is, there's something about scholars that the English language isn't good enough for them. They have to go grab some Latin words or some Greek words and slap those together in order to make big words that sound smart, that are multisyllabic. Multisyllabic, have more than one syllable. They just like to slap those together. Fun times. Am I glad that I didn't hear whatever got said back there? Here's the thing. The Bible tells us we should absolutely expect to see this, that as we look around our world, we will see the fingerprints of the Creator. Romans 1:20, since the creation of the world, God's invisible attributes, his eternal power, divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that people are without excuse. Someone asked on Facebook, in a group I'm in, someone asked, what are some good books to read for studying on the existence of God? What are some good books you would recommend? And I said, well, it depends. If you're more of a math person, I'd go with Sudoku. If you're more of a word person, go maybe crosswords or something, and just go sit on a beach or go get a cabin in the mountains or something. And there you go. You'll see all the evidence for the existence of God you need, because creation screams to us the existence of God. And so, okay, now we're going to get into the big egghead word, teleological. And all that means is it's designed for a purpose. Kind of the classic design argument case that you'll hear people make or refer to was from Paley, theologian, scholar named Paley. He proposed what is referred to as the watchmaker argument. Say you're walking along, and you look down and you see a pocket watch and you pick it up. You're automatically going to know that was made. That there wasn't like some accident of nature that formed a rock or metal into this weird shape with these gears and springs and all these parts and pieces, right? You look at it and you know that was made because of the intricacy, because of the specificity, there's purpose to it. And so, it was made. Someone else made that and put it there. Same thing goes for the world. Hold on. My microphone is driving me nuts. No, I just didn't have it properly situated. So, okay, here's hoping. I won't say easy, but a good way to at least start to begin to think about this. Cold case homicide detective J. Warner Wallace, right? We've talked about him. We've done study of his. We'll actually see a clip of him here in a minute. He has a book called God's Crime Scene. And the general idea of his book is what they do when you go to a crime scene, right? He says, whenever you witness a murder or there's a dead body. That's all they know. Detectives on the scene, there's a dead body. Well, there's multiple ways that body could be there. Could have been accident. Could have been suicide. Right? Or could have been homicide. Someone else did it. And so the question is that he asks is, can the things that are in the room explain the dead body? And that way you'll know it's either suicide. It's a suicide or an accident. But if it cannot be explained by what is in the room, then someone came in and made it happen. And so In that book, however, he lays out one of the reasons why we know the things in the universe do not explain the universe is because there are certain features to design. And he actually made up this acrostic using the word design of 8 features of something that is designed. Now, for something to be designed, for you to look and recognize design, it doesn't have to have all 8. But these are 8 features that generally things that are designed will have. This won't be on the test, but let me go over them real quick. Dubious probability, right? That the chances of it happening randomly is just kind of bizarre. Right? Like, no, that's just way too high. It's just not likely that's going to happen by chance. Echoes of familiarity. You look at it and you go, that looks like something I've seen before. That, you know, this thing looks like that thing. So you're seeing some pattern recognition. Sophistication and intricacy, right? If there's specificity, sophistication, then you would expect something that's more complex is going to more likely have been designed. If there's information dependency, right? If it's something that there had to be information to do it, it couldn't have gotten done just by happenstance. There's obviously information involved. Goal, direction, intentionality, right? The form and process of the object appear to be goal-directed. It's there to accomplish something, like the watch, right? It tells time. It's got something it's there for. It's not just complex, but it has a purpose. In natural inexplicability, man, they love these big words, don't they? Given the laws of physics or chemistry, are the laws of physics and chemistry insufficient to account for the form and function of the object? Good example of this might be like an arrowhead, right? You find a flint arrowhead, and you're like, oh, it's a rock. Well, but natural forces are not going to shape a rock to look like that, you know. Something happened. This was designed. This was done on purpose. Irreducible complexity. It's got parts that it you need all the parts there in order for it to function and be what it is, right? That any one part missing, then you don't even have a thing. And then decision or choice reflection. It looks like evidence that someone would have had to make a choice to do this. It wouldn't have just happened. Those are just some general ideas that typically these things show something is designed. In the picture there, he's got a nest, and in the book he actually shows how a bird's nest fits all these qualities, and it's designed by a bird. Bird designed it to be its nest. So, and that is just some general idea that whenever you see things that have these kind of features, that you go, wait a minute, that looks designed. And then so the question is, does the universe, does the world around us have those kind of features? And I say they absolutely do. If we just look at the planet Earth, I mean, just looking at the planet Earth, there are so many factors that have to be exactly right that the planet fits into, that the idea that it could happen just by random chance is absurd. And so there's all sorts of different things just about Earth. So let's look at a few of them. I saw this one online and I thought, wow, that's one. Tacos. There is no other planet in the solar system suitable for tacos. Right? Too close to the sun, there's no tacos. Get further away from the sun, there's no tacos. But on Earth, we have tacos. Sorry, I saw that and I laughed and I thought, oh, I've got to use that. This, however, is making a fun joke on this fact that the Earth sits in what is called the Goldilocks zone in the solar system. Not too hot, not too cold, just right. Right? Mercury and Venus, scorched wastelands. Mars and everything else out, frozen or gaseous, you know, uninhabitable. But Earth, just right there in that right spot where, because it's not too hot and because it's not too cold, it's possible for life to exist on Earth. And where you have life, you have tacos. So praise God for tacos. You also have the fact of the rate of spin of the Earth, right? Because we're going around and around in circles. But if we were going faster or too much slower, you wouldn't be able to have life on Earth. If we're going faster, it would create harsher weather conditions. And the force of it, the centrifugal, there's not actually a centrifugal, that's not really a word, centripetal. I always forget which ones, but yeah. And so the force at the, if it was spinning faster, it would actually force the water to the equator. So you would actually flood the equator if it was spinning faster. And then the speed of the spin would create catastrophic weather. Hurricanes would just, it's like we would be, dreaming for a category 5 because we'd be hitting, category 10s and whatever. If it was going slower, your days and nights would last longer, which would interrupt certain ecological cycles that are going on the planet, right? Because you got too much sunlight just scorching things. You don't have the nighttime for rejuvenation. Longer days, longer nights, extreme temperatures. So the rate of spin, not too fast, not too slow, just right. However, the Earth could also use a V8 because it's got a little bit of a tilt going on. Anyone else remember those commercials? People walking like this. It's like, oh, should have had a V8. The Earth actually sits at about a 23-degree tilt. The nice thing about that tilt is that's what causes our seasons. Because as it rotates, as it goes around the sun, and as it rotates, it changes kind of which areas are facing the sun, and so it creates our seasons. If we didn't have a tilt, we wouldn't have seasons. If it was just straight up, no seasons. If it was tilted too much further, we'd have extreme seasons, and the length of days and daylight hours would be different in different for different parts. And so you'd have areas that would be, just like in nighttime for, months, which we already have a little bit in the Arctic, but it would be drastic, massive portions of the planet. The moon. If the moon was bigger or smaller or closer or further away, you got that? I wonder if somebody would. So if the moon was bigger, like if we had a bigger moon, it could actually, because the gravity of the moon and the Earth interacting, it could actually cause the Earth and the moon to kind of lock in place. Not, you know how the moon, we only see one side of the moon. The way the gravity would interact, it would actually get to the point to where the moon would only basically, it would have a geosynchronous orbit. So it would only be stuck to the same spot. So only one half of the Earth would ever see the moon and the other half would never see it, which would also mean that you would have just massive portion of the Earth that would be in darkness for longer, because you'd have an eclipse every day. Every time you come around, you have an eclipse for most of the day. And that's if we had a larger moon. If we had a larger moon like that, life at the equator would be like the Arctic, where you have darkness for longer periods of the day, possibly months at a time. A larger moon, if you know, the moon interacts with the oceans. It's the gravity of the moon that actually causes the tides. And so if you had a bigger moon, larger gravity, you'd have harsher, more extreme tides, where it wouldn't be, the tide's coming in. It would be a tsunami coming in. People couldn't live on the coasts because it'd be getting washed away on regular. If the moon was smaller, we would have weaker tides. If it was too much smaller, not enough gravity, the oceans wouldn't have the tides. You could actually go stagnant. And a stagnant water, you don't have the life. If the moon was closer, you would have extreme tides, floods, earthquakes, volcanoes, as the gravity of the moon acting on the Earth. If it was further away, you'd have weaker tides and all the problems that go along with that. And so, again, there's something else where it's not too far away, not too close, not too big, not too small, but it's just right. Then you have Jupiter. I like Jupiter. Aside from being a really cool looking planet, Jupiter is the vacuum cleaner of the solar system. Jupiter is actually so big and its gravity pull is so hard that Jupiter doesn't actually orbit the sun. Jupiter and the sun are kind of doing this swinging around kind of thing. So it's not just like, you know, sun and Jupiter going around. They're both kind of swinging around each other a little bit. But Jupiter's pull, gravitational pull, is so strong that it pulls debris to itself. It's the vacuum cleaner of the solar system. So there are comets and meteors and all sorts of things that never make it to the inner solar system to be a danger for Earth because Jupiter's out there attracting it all. And so he's the target, taking all that upon himself. And then you have our position in the Milky Way galaxy is also just right. If we were closer in, where the stars are denser and closer together, then we would be bombarded from all directions with intense solar radiation from the closer stars that our magnetic field would not be able to protect us from all that cosmic radiation. We are at a point where we're able to witness the night sky and see all that. If we were further out, I'm not exactly sure. I couldn't find, you know, what scientists speculate would happen if we were further out. But I know definitely being closer in isn't very good. And so, again, good position in our galaxy. So there you have just the situation of the Earth. And that's just a handful of things. Any thoughts or questions on that before we go look at a few other issues about the order and design of the universe and the Earth? I don't know. Yeah, there's, and I'm not sure, right, if you didn't catch, the question was about the shape of the solar system. Right now it's all, you know, pretty much a flat plane. I mean, there's a little bit of, you know, angle to some of the planet's orbits, but it's generally, and I don't know. So, yeah, I'm not an astronomer. So, good question. You look that up and get back to us next week. Anything else? Well, not after that. You're handing out assignments. So there we go. We got the Goldilocks planet. All right. Not too hot, not too cold. All right. One thing that I think, whenever you're talking about design, whenever you're talking about, let's take a look at creation, let's take a look at what we can figure out and the things that we know, and it absolutely just screams, yes, there is a God, that I think just puts a nail in the coffin of any claim that there's not, is our DNA. That's one of those things that, I mean, once I, you know, in school learned about DNA, I'm like, there's a God. How can you not see this? And that's because DNA contains information. Not just information. DNA is what tells your cells what to make. All the little parts and pieces that are in your cells and all the things that go on, DNA is the instruction. This is the blueprint for what your cells do. And you have basically four molecules, I guess is the word. And then you got that double helix thing and all those little ribs in between them is the information. And that is basically a digital code. It's like an alphabet. It's a language. And that tells your cells what to do. And this isn't just, you know, preacher guy trying to make things up to make it look like stuff. Here is Richard Dawkins, who is an evolutionary biologist who is a fierce opponent of religion. He was one of the four horsemen of the New Atheism. Back in like 2001, there were four guys that came along and they wrote books that just, you know, were instant bestsellers, and they were on all the speaking tours. Very anti-religion. And he says, the machine code of the genes is uncannily computer-like. Apart from differences in jargon, the pages of a molecular biology journal might be interchanged with those of a computer engineering journal. So what you get that? What we see in our DNA is like computer software. It's programming. How do you get a computer program? You got to have a computer programmer to write the code. That's the only place information comes from like that. And so that is Richard Dawkins, no friend of religion in general or Christianity in particular. And he's saying your DNA, yeah, that's a computer language in your cells. I don't think so. I think he's still out there kicking. that's Stephen Hawking, the guy in the wheelchair. Yeah. Yeah, it was a few years ago, I think. 10 years ago or so. No. Yeah. Which is really funny because a lot of the things that he discovered actually point to God. Oh, yeah. We'll actually get to that here in a minute. Francis Crick, who was one of the people who discovered the DNA molecule, I believe, he says, whenever talking about information in DNA, he says, by information, I mean the specification of the amino acid sequence in the protein. The information means here the precise determination of sequence, either of bases in the nucleic acid or of amino acid residues in the protein. So proteins are the machines. They're the things in your cells that are actually doing stuff. And he says that, you know, they're made up of what's called amino acids. And those have to go in the exact, amino acids come in different shapes and different types. And they have to go in the exact order and exact position in order to create something, a protein that serves a function. And so he's saying that that's what there's blueprints. This information, this is blueprint that's going on. It has to be done exactly this way in order for it to work. I forget the name of this little guy, but this is a protein. It's a animated rendering. This isn't an actual picture of the protein. But basically, in your cells, you have these, basically, they're like roads going around in your cells. And this is a protein that carries nutrients, different molecules and things around your cell doing stuff. And it does that because your DNA has the blueprints on how to build that. It's like you don't get that kind of thing just popping up out of nowhere for no reason. That is information that is directed purpose behind that. And so then this guy, he's a chemist, Michael Polanyi, I think is how you pronounce that. He says, the arrangement, just as the arrangement of a printed page is extraneous to the chemistry of the printed page, so is the base sequence of a DNA molecule extraneous to the chemical forces at work in the DNA. Basically, that's saying, yes, just because you can identify the chemistry of DNA, that has nothing to do with the information found in the DNA. You can take this sheet of paper and you can test it to find out what the paper is made of, what the ink is made of, and how all of that is made physically. And none of that will tell you any bit how to understand what's written on it. Same thing with your DNA. You can understand all the chemistry all day long about what makes up DNA. That doesn't tell you anything about the meaning of the information held within it. So everywhere we look, we see features of design in the earth and where it's positioned, in our cells and our DNA and everything that's going on there. You have trillions of cells that make up your body, and every single one of them has the amount of activity going on inside of it like New York City. Yeah, and if you unplug just one bit, right? That's what cancer is. Something in the cell went wrong. And so, okay. Now, there is one thing I want to get to. It's not my favorite part of design arguments, but it is one of the more popular that are out there, so I figure we'd get mention of it. Having to do with certain constants within the universe, mathematical constants, like gravity. Video we're about to watch, you know, talks about the strong nuclear force, which is the force that keeps atoms together, your nucleus and your, you know, protons and electrons, you know, the force that holds them together. And there's several other things that scientists have identified that are constant measurements. And if they were just a little bit off, nothing would work. The reason I'm not particularly fond of this argument is because a lot of it is either has to do with, is based on, or related to Big Bang theory, you know, model of cosmology in the beginning of the universe being all those billions of years old. However, people can argue about the age and the distance and the length and just how well science can do all that stuff or whatever. It doesn't change the fact that here today in 2021, we can measure these things and we know they're incredibly fine-tuned. Whatever you want to argue about the Big Bang. And you don't have to accept the Big Bang. When you're talking to someone who does accept the Big Bang, you can say, well, you know, according to the universal constants of the universe originated in the Big Bang, fine-tuning, therefore God. And so let's take a look at this about the probability of it. This first video, we're going to look at the argument first. This is the actual formal argument that we'll be kind of taking a look at. The fine-tuning, right, all of these little bits and pieces and things being exactly right, exactly the way they need to be in order for life to be here, the fine-tuning of the universe is due to either necessity, right, laws of physics that just had to happen, chance, it's all random, just happened to be this way, or by design. It is not due to physical necessity or chance, therefore it must be by design. If the first two statements are true, the third statement must be true. And so let's take a look at this. This is a quick video with J. Warner Wallace explaining the probabilities of just one of these constants being exactly what it is. He's quoting a physicist there, says that everyone agrees the universe looks as if it was designed for life. Right, the word fine-tuning is not a religious word. That's a scientific word. Even atheists, scientists admit the fine-tuning. They just say it looks like it was designed. It has the illusion of design or the appearance of design. They don't think it was designed. So let's take a look here at what he's got to say.
Imagine that we were to take our North American continent and we were to stack so that there is not a single square inch anywhere on the continent that does not have a dime on it. In other words, we're going to get all kinds of dimes out, and we're going to put them all over the entire North American continent so that every dime is touching every other dime and there's no spaces in between. Could you imagine how many dimes we're talking about? A lot of dimes. Now let's imagine that we begin stacking on each of those dimes, and we stack the dimes all the way, covering the entire North American continent, all the way to the moon. Okay? Sound good so far? It's not enough. Let's increase that by 1 billion times more. Now, you're getting an idea of how many dimes we have. That's a lot of dimes. Agreed? Now, imagine I was to blindfold you and tell you that there is one red dime in that stack. All I need you to do is to pick it. What are the odds that you would pick the one red dime? Well, these are the odds in numerical, this 1 in a 10 to the 37th chance. That is the same level of precision that is involved in the strong nuclear force that holds together. If you're off by just a dime in either direction, we don't get a universe that supports life. If you're off by a dime in either direction, Do you see how finely tuned this force is? Let me put you another way. What if I said all you have to do is to get a .22 rifle and hit this bullseye? Now, the bullseye is 1 inch wide, and all you have to do is hit it. And I said, okay, that doesn't seem too hard, right? A lot of you are good shots here. You could probably hit that bullseye from wherever you are in the room. How many of you think no matter where you are in the room, you can hit that bullseye? Raise your hand. That's a lot of good shots. I'm going to get out of your way. But what if I told you that the bullseye was actually at the opposite end of the observable universe? 1 inch wide, opposite end of the observable universe. Now, if you hit it, this is pretty wild. As a matter of fact, the odds are not great. It's a 1 in 10 to the 60th chance. And that is exactly what the calibration is of the mass density of the universe. 1 inch off the target in either direction, and you don't have a universe like ours. Do you see how finely tuned this constant is? This is why a theoretical physicist you might know from television says it this way. It's shocking to find out how many of our familiar constants of the universe lie within a very narrow band that makes life possible. If a single one of these accidents, he calls them accidents, did you see what he calls them? If a single one of these accidents were altered, stars would never form, the universe would fly apart, DNA would not exist, life as we know it would be impossible, Earth would flip over and freeze, and so on. He's being serious. And he believes that this level of fine-tuning is purely an accident. Isn't that interesting? It's amazing to me how many thoughtful, smart people are willing to ignore the fine-tuning of the universe and say it's just an accident. Really? So if Mikio Kaku was sitting at a poker table in Vegas, he's just sitting there playing cards, and the house deals two of his friends, and they finally deal him, and they say, okay, and they deal themselves. And Mikio's sitting over here, and he's like, yeah, okay, cool. Looks at his cards, he's going, oh, gosh, I got a good hand here. I'm going to bet some money on this. And he bets everything he has or everything he can think of. He puts it all on the table. And then the house turns over their cards, and they've got a royal flush. Really? I thought I had a good hand. Now, in his mind, if he knew the odds of the house dealing themselves a royal flush from a single deck, that would be 10 to the 5.813, a 1 in 650,000 chance of dealing yourself a royal flush. That's why you should never play those poker machines and hoping for the royal flush. Oh, I've got three of the five cards, and you're going to actually hoping you get a 1 in 650,000 chance, really? So I can see, though, if he's playing cards here, and he might get frustrated and say, okay, well, and it does happen, right? I mean, you maybe have seen it. It's possible to get a royal. It's not that outrageous. Okay, so he stays in the game, and they deal a second hand. And now he looks at his second hand, and he goes, oh, my gosh, a straight flush. That's good, right? So what else can I? He puts his house on the line, okay? He mortgages his house, puts his bet, and sure enough, another royal flush. Really? What are the odds of somebody dealing themselves two consecutive royal flushes with one? Really? You want to know what they are? They're this. I think at this point, most reasonable people would say, nay, nay. Something's not legit here. I'm out. But no, he's committed to his worldview, so he stays in. And sure enough, the house deals three royal flushes. What are the odds of this happening? Pretty high. Do you see our number so far? Well, that number, how does that relate to some of our universal constants? Let me show you the number, for example, of the strength of gravity, the calibration. I want you to see what this number is, just so you have a sense. How many royal flushes would you have to deal in a row to approximate this number? A bunch. It turns out you would need six royal flushes in a row to get to the calibration for gravity, which is, now, how many does it take to get to this calibration? This is the calibration necessary for quarks. If you know anything about physics, I won't go into all the details, but these are the kind of, I've written it out here for you. The mass is associated with particles. This is really about the nucleus of the atom and how these hold together. You have to have a certain ratio of these. If it's too high or too low, you don't get atoms to form, blah, 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 blah. But how do I get to this number? That's a high number. How many royal flushes am I willing to sit through? Well, it turns out you would have to have 12 royal flushes to approximate that number in a row. What about the precision required to calibrate the energy density of space? That's 10 to the 90th power. That means you got to sit at the table, and he takes that same deck of cards, and he deals himself not 12 in a row, but a bunch more in a row. So it seems to me, if Mikio Kaku is so committed to his worldview that he refuses to believe that something is, are you really going to sit through that many royal, before you'd say, get away from me, this is all a scam. There's no way you can deal that many. To deny that God, that somebody, something has fine-tuned the universes, the universe and the constants in the universe would be as stupid as sitting there and allowing somebody to deal themselves 28 royal flushes in a row and not get up from the table. Now, if this happened to you, you're gone. Two royal flushes in, you're gone, right? If it happens twice, you're out of there. Yet these smart people would allow themselves to be dealt this 28 times and still say, yeah, this is the way it is. I guess I'm unlucky.
There's just a taste of the improbability that this universe could exist and it not be God doing it. The idea that there is no God is so improbable, it is absurd to think we could have this world without God. I got one more little video that I want to show to actually give an actual good breakdown of the argument. Like I said, this isn't necessarily the favorite argument and all the, you know, fine-tuning, you know, constants of the universe and all that stuff. Digging deep into the science, that's why I'm showing some clips. But any thoughts or questions on that before we jump into this last bit? Yeah. Well, and that's just for one, right? And it's like, you know, he was talking about that one is the force that holds the nucleus of the atom together. Okay, well, that's one. And then the other one he did was the force of gravity. Well, okay, that one, you have to have both of them exactly right. And then you got the strong nuclear force, which is the one that holds the electrons, you know, to the nucleus, you know, and that was what, 1 in 10 to the 37th, which, by the way, that whenever it says 1 times 10 to the whatever, that's a one with that many zeros behind it. So that's the number, 1 with 37 zeros behind it. We don't even have a name for that kind of number. Okay, so but that's just another one. And there's like a dozen of these things. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah. Playing the lottery. You have a better chance of winning the lottery while being struck by lightning than you do of the universe existing without God. Okay. So to give a little bit of a breakdown of the actual kind of formal argument and some of the explanation of it, this is a video from Reasonable Faith is the name of the organization. Dr. William Lane Craig is his organization, philosopher, theologian, really bright guy. There was once, I think it was an atheist that described William Lane Craig as the guy who puts the fear of God into atheists who debate him. There's only one debate that I know of that most people would agree, yeah, he probably lost that one. And that was real science heavy. It wasn't, and he was debating against a physicist. And he's a philosopher. But some people argue he even won that one. But anyway, This is his organization has a handful of really neat animated videos they've put together. Again, link is in the description of this video. But this is just going to be a short bit of their explanation of this argument and kind of the formal layout of it.
Wherever physicists look, they see examples of fine-tuning. The remarkable fact is that the values of these numbers seem to have been very finely adjusted to make possible the development of life. If anyone claims not to be surprised by the special features that the universe has, he's hiding his head in the sand. These special features are surprising and unlikely. What is the best explanation for this astounding phenomenon? There are three live options. The fine-tuning of the universe is due to either physical necessity, chance, or design. Which of these options is the most plausible? According to this alternative, the universe must be life-permitting. The precise values of these constants and quantities could not be otherwise. But is this plausible? Is a life-prohibiting universe impossible? Far from it. It's not only possible, it's far more likely than a life-permitting universe. The constants and quantities are not determined by the laws of nature. There's no reason or evidence suggests that fine-tuning is necessary. How about chance? Did we just get really, 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 really lucky? No. The probabilities involved are so ridiculously remote as to put the fine-tuning well beyond the reach of chance. So, in an effort to keep this option alive, some have gone beyond empirical science and opted for a more speculative approach, known as the multiverse. They imagine a universe generator that cranks out such a vast number of universes that odds are life-permitting universes will eventually pop out. However, there's no scientific evidence for the existence of this multiverse. It cannot be detected, observed, measured, or proved. And the universe generator itself would require an enormous amount of fine-tuning. Furthermore, small patches of order are far more probable than big ones. So the most probable observable universe would be a small one inhabited by a single, simple observer. But what we actually observe is the very thing that we should least expect, a vast, spectacularly complex, highly ordered universe inhabited by billions of other observers. So even if the multiverse existed, which is a moot point, it wouldn't do anything to explain the fine-tuning. Given the implausibility of physical necessity or chance, the best explanation for why the universe is fine-tuned for life may very well be it was designed that way. A common sense interpretation of the facts suggests that a super intellect monkeyed with physics and that there are no blind forces worth speaking about in nature. The numbers one calculates from the facts seem to me so overwhelming as to put this conclusion almost beyond question. There is for me powerful evidence that there is something going on behind it all. It seems as though somebody has fine-tuned nature's numbers to make the universe. The impression of design is overwhelming. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge.
So, I mean, the evidence is all there. The probabilities are obnoxious. You know, I mean, it's everything is just right, and the probability of it being just right is so absurdly high. It boggles the mind that anyone would willingly choose to disbelieve in God. People who know this stuff, scientists who know this stuff, go, well, every now and then you get someone who gives you a really honest moment where they, you know, say the quiet part out loud. I wish I could remember. I meant to look up the quote. There's a scientist who flat out says, well, and there's all kinds of other people you can find who will say, you know, well, there has to be some other explanation because it can't be God. Why not? You know, there's one quote where, you know, he says, we have to assume a natural explanation. Otherwise, we allow a divine foot in the door. You know, and it's just, no, it's just bias and closed-mindedness. The funny thing that where atheists, especially science-obsessed atheists, try to say that, you know, Christians are so closed-minded. Well, they're the ones who put their blinders on and won't, you know, consider the possibility of other things outside of their physical, natural, science-based world, right? We're able to follow science and see what it teaches us and what we can learn from it. And then we also know there's other things out there beyond the natural. And so, one last quote. Ooh, that's tiny. Sorry about that. Anthony Flew. Anthony Flew was a famous atheist philosopher who spent, I think he was a scientist. I know he's a philosopher. I mean, he spent 50 years railing against religion. And he says, I now believe that the universe was brought into existence by an infinite intelligence. I believe that this universe's intricate laws manifest what scientists have called the mind of God. I believe that life and reproduction, I believe that life and reproduction originate in a divine source. Why do I believe this? Given that I expounded and defended atheism for more than a half century, the short answer is this. Thinking of all kinds of great quotes. So there was a guy who said that, wish I remember the quote, you may have heard it, that, you know, if first drink from the well of science make you doubt that God exists, you know, but if you drink deep from it, then you'll know, you know, you can't doubt that he is. But there we go. Since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, eternal power, divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that no one has an excuse. Everyone's without excuse. I give the example of, you know, the speed limit sign. Whenever you're going along and those red and blue lights show up behind you and you go, oh, I didn't see the sign. It was right there. You weren't looking or you didn't want to see it. There is no excuse. It's right there for everyone to see. Creation's the same way. The evidence that God is there, it's right there for everyone to see. All you got to do is look. To not see it almost takes a willful, or not almost, it does take a willful ignorance. So, okay, I'm done yapping. Final thoughts or questions? Yeah. Well, and to be fair, the video kind of, you know, makes a cartoony little machine popping out. You know, they don't really think it's a machine, but. Yeah. Well, and you know, it's grasping at straws. They do not want to believe in God, and so they will come up with anything else because they cannot consider that option. They won't let themselves. Yeah. Fall apart. Yeah. 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 And the crazy thing is, like, the more we discover, the more complex, the more improbable it gets to where... Pretty much infinite probability. Oh yeah. I mean, because you just, it, well, I mean, it's such a great number. It might as well be infinite, you know? Yeah. It's, there actually is. So someone's crunched the numbers and I forget what the number is, but the probability when you put all those together is greater than the number of particles in the estimated in the known universe. Mm. Yeah. How many royal flushes are you going to sit through in a row before you go, I think they might be cheating? Oh yeah. My What's really funny is, so I was listening to something, they're talking about insects and the way insects' wings actually work, you know, because scientists were just confused by the bumblebee, right? How does this thing fly? It's just this ball with these little wings and that shouldn't work. But now with high-speed capture cameras and things they've been learning about fluid dynamics and everything, they've noticed that the wings don't do up and down. They do a rotation method that's where they're twisting and doing it while they're rotating, and it actually creates a vortex above the wing, so that's low pressure, so it's able to lift. And that's a bee. That's creating, you know, a flight system that we couldn't even imagine. Yeah. And so, yeah, my favorite, like the improbability thing, is the bombardier beetle. There's a beetle that actually has cannons mounted on its butt. That it has chemicals inside it that it mixes and it gives off a boom. And it can actually direct it and it gives off a gaseous, you know, pop to scare off predators. Anyway, okay, we're over time. Let's pray real quick and get out of here. Father God, we thank you. We thank you that just creation lays before us, that we can see your amazing handiwork, and that everywhere we look, whether we look to the stars or look deep within ourselves, God, that we just see the evidence of your creation all around us. We thank you that you have made it so well known. In Jesus' name, amen.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds.